Hello, everyone. My name is Turner Sanderson. I'm a registered dietitian and I am a certified nutrition support clinician. Today, I'm going to be talking with you about enteral nutrition and gastric bypass surgery. So what is gastric bypass surgery or bariatric surgery? Basic definition, it's a surgery that's going to help people lose weight. The gastric bypass surgery, it is going to alter a patient's stomach or small intestines, which is going to change how that patient handles food. And it is also going to result in that patient or individual eating less, which is going to contribute to weight loss. To be considered for bariatric surgery, the patient must have a BMI greater than 40, or they can have a BMI greater than 35 with at least one comorbidity, such as diabetes, cardiomyopathy, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, severe joint disease, and there's a handful of more. But if they have a BMI of 35 with at least one comorbidity, then they can be considered for bariatric surgery. With bariatric surgery, there are three types or three areas that you can break the surgeries into. That is a restrictive surgery, that is a surgery that is just malabsorptive, or there are surgeries that's a combination of both. So the first category, restrictive, most people would consider laparoscopic banding as strictly restrictive because the GI tract is not being altered at all. There's a band being placed around the stomach, which is altering the stomach pouch, which is going to result in people eating less, which is going to result in weight loss. Some people consider sleeve gastrectomy as just restrictive. Some people consider it as a combination of both restrictive and malabsorptive. But with the sleeve gastrectomy, the GI tract is not being altered. The food is still going through the same process, same flow of stomach to small intestines. But with that procedure, about two-thirds of the stomach is being removed. So there can be some malabsorption taking place. The procedure that is strictly considered malabsorption is going to be your biliopancreatic diversion. This procedure is very advanced, very complicated. Out of all the procedures that I've mentioned so far, it makes up about 5% of gastric bypass procedures. But with it, there is a lot of malabsorption. Out of all of them, there are going to be potential for micronutrient deficiencies. But with the biliopancreatic diversion, there is also going to be some restriction or deficiencies in your macronutrients as well. All of them are going to lead to less intake, which is going to contribute to the deficiencies. But with a biliopancreatic diversion, it can lead to some macronutrient deficiencies as well as micronutrient deficiencies. Now, a true combination of both is going to be your Roux-en-Y gastric bypass surgery. With that, there's going to be a small stomach pouch made, and then majority of the stomach is being bypassed, as well as the duodenum, as well as the upper part of your jejunum. So with those areas of your GI tract being bypassed, there's most certainly going to be some restriction as well as malabsorption. Further talking about nutrition deficiencies between those categories and between those procedures, the nutrient deficiencies are usually more severe in your malabsorptive procedures, such as your biliopancreatic diversion. Current recommendations for routine vitamin and mineral supplementation in your gastric bypass and your biliopancreatic diversion include a standard adult or prenatal multivitamin twice daily, a calcium citrate, vitamin D, vitamin B12, folic acid, and elemental iron supplement can help prevent those deficiencies. Now, this talk is considered an overview. We could dive in and spend an hour just talking about deficiencies and how to manage those and recommendations for those. But just know the deficiencies are common. There are a lot more resources out there to view on how to manage those. But it is recommended just a routine multivitamin or prenatal vitamin, and to be sure that they are getting calcium, vitamin D, vitamin B12, folic acid, and elemental iron with those. When we try to decide between enteral nutrition and parenteral nutrition, the deciding factor is going to be, is the GI tract functional? If the GI tract is functional, then we most certainly want to use it. We want to utilize that. And, you know, kind of some guidelines that we follow. If we have a patient who is not critically ill, and we know that they're not going to receive oral nutrition for at least 7 to 10 days, then we want to go ahead and initiate enteral nutrition as fast as we can. And if it's a patient who is critically ill, they're in MICU or SICU, and we know, hey, they're not going to get any oral nutrition for 5 to 7 days, so it's a little shorter period, then let's go ahead and initiate enteral nutrition as fast as we can. Reasons why we would not do enteral nutrition and we would want to go towards parenteral nutrition is, one, if the GI tract is not functional. If the patient has a fistula, ischemia, some type of stricture, some type of obstruction, stricture, if there is intractable nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, if the malabsorption is severe, and that's kind of leading to their main complication of maybe the malabsorption is so severe that it's leading to malnutrition and we're trying to treat that, then we would most certainly want to use the parenteral nutrition. After we have decided, you know, are we going to do enteral nutrition or are we going to do parenteral nutrition? If we're doing enteral nutrition, then we need to decide the access point. So when we consider the access point, we are considering the method of feeding. Are we going to do a bolus feed, intermittent feed? Are we going to do a continuous feed? And by answering those, essentially, it's going to help answer the access point. Now, as I talk about, you know, access point, it's going to be very vital that we obviously include the surgeon, the medical team when we consider access. It ultimately have to be approved by the surgeon, whether he agrees it's good, it can be feasible. But as dietitians, and as we think through the process of what are we recommending here, where do we want to start? We'll think to ourselves, hey, can this patient get a bolus feed? Okay. If they have a normal, stomach pouch, such as somebody who might have the sleeve gastrectomy, whereas, you know, they still have a larger portion of their stomach, they possibly could receive bolus feeds. In that case, I think it would be better to do a gravity feed, whereas they're getting maybe larger amounts, but it's spread out a little more. Personally, with any of the gastric bypass surgeries, I would try to lean away from bolus feeds because in all of the situations, their stomach has been altered. But if we are going to do bolus feeds, such as in a sleeve gastrectomy, we want to be sure that, it's spread out a little bit. It's a little slower because if we initiate that and it's done at a full load, that can lead to some discomfort, nausea, vomiting, aspiration, and those are all things that we want to avoid. So bolus, it can be considered, but there has to be, a larger stomach available to us. Even with the gastric banding, while there, the stomach is still there, it has been altered. So your typical bolus amount might be affected, and it might could lead to some discomfort, bloating, and aspiration. And those are things that we most certainly want to avoid if we can. So the next thing we want to consider is intermittent or continuous. When we think of continuous feeds, that is something that is being assisted by a pump. And those are great for, your gastric banding, for your sleeve gastrectomy. Those are even, a continuous that's controlled by a pump is going to be good even for your gastric bypass, your Roux-en-Y gastric bypass, because we can slow the rate, we can control it, and it can be better, essentially better tolerated because of the slower rate. far as access points, if we look or if we consider the gastric banding, you could do an NG tube, you could do an OG tube, because the pouch, the reservoir is available. You know, it would be complicated to do a PEG because you're accessing a very small pouch. Is it possible? Sure. Don't know if that's the best option there. If, you know, obviously if there is something that has gone wrong with the banding and the stomach is no longer an option, maybe because there was an erosion with the banding or other complications, a J-tube is an option. With that, we're just bypassing the stomach and we're feeding straight into the small intestine. If you go to the vertical sleeve gastrectomy, of course, NG tube, OG tube, both of those are options. Where you're feeding as normal into the stomach. A PEG possibly could be considered. You know, once again, that's a conversation that we would have with the medical team, with the surgeon. You know, see if it's approved by everyone. Is an option. I don't know if it's the best option. If you think about a J tube, that is fine as well. If there's a problem with the stomach and there's a reason why we're avoiding the stomach, feeding into the small intestine with a J tube would be perfectly fine. If you go to the Roux-en-Y gastric bypass, obviously a PEG tube is out of the picture with that one because there is no reservoir, there's no stomach necessarily that is available to us. So you would be looking at feeding into the small intestines. That's going to be mainly with your J-tube. The NG tube, OG tube is possible, but you would have to have the surgeon there on board with it as far as placing the tube because of the altering of the GI tract. With your biliopancreatic diversion, more complicated, you're more looking at a J-tube with that one. A PEG tube is not an option for us in that scenario. When we think about formula selection, in most cases, you know, a polymeric formula can be used if the GI tract is functional. If you know we're utilizing the stomach with like a gastric banding or a sleeve gastrectomy, a polymeric formula can be utilized. If we're looking at the gastric bypass where there's more malabsorption taking place because more of your GI tract has been altered or bypassed, same thing for your biliopancreatic diversion. For those, we would want to, you know, possibly consider an elemental formula where, you know, the nutrients are pre-digested and they can be easily tolerated and absorbed by our patients in that scenario. When determining calorie and protein needs for the obese patient who has had gastric bypass surgery, things can be a little challenging when we're trying to determine what is needed. The best way to determine that is to use indirect calorimetry if that is available to you. If that is not available to you, then a various predictive equations can be used. Some that are recommended for the obese population is going to be your Mifflin St. Jor or your Penn State 1998 equation. Alternatively, energy requirements have been estimated with simpler weight-based equations. For instance, Aspen recommendations, they recommend 11 to 14 kcal per kilogram or 22 to 25 kcal per kilogram. And that is based on ideal body weight for your obese patient. You want to consider the 11 to 14 kcal per kilogram range of actual weight if the BMI is less than 50. If the BMI is greater than 50, then we would want to use a 22 to 25 kcal per kilogram for ideal body weight. So that is a simpler weight-based equation that can be used. With the bariatric patient, the obese patient, it has been recommended and approved to use hypocaloric, high-protein feeds. With the high-protein feeds, you know, you're looking at anywhere from 2 to 2.5 grams per kilogram of ideal body weight of protein. For a patient who is in the obesity class of 1 to 2, that's going to be, you're looking closer to the 2 grams per kilogram of ideal body weight of protein. If they are in the obese class of 3 or higher, then you'd be looking at a 2.5 gram per kilogram of ideal body weight. Now, providing that amount of protein can be challenging. Some formulas are more concentrated. They provide more protein than others. So in most cases, a protein modular is going to be needed to meet those high amount of protein requirements for those patients. So that is something to consider. Something that, you know, that we'll want to monitor far as a patient receiving enteral nutrition, as well as parenteral nutrition, with these patients who have had some type of bariatric surgery, that is nutrient deficiencies. With a patient, you know, they are more prone to have, you know, micronutrient deficiencies. That is something that we want to monitor very closely. So just something to know, most enteral formulas meet 100% of the dietary reference intakes for most vitamins and minerals, you know, for your healthy population. However, to prevent deficiencies with bariatric surgery patients, we want to be sure that they're getting the, you know, the appropriate supplementation for vitamins and minerals as required for bariatric surgery patients. So once again, want to monitor, you know, their micronutrient levels closely to make sure there's no deficiencies. If we come across deficiencies, we want to address that with the medical team and replenish those as fast as we can. When we think about enteral nutrition, our nutrition support in the gastric surgery patients, things can be complicated. This video, you know, is a brief overview. You know, I hope it helps you think through some things, you know, gets your wheels turning, you know, points you in the right directions in certain areas. But it is an overview. There are a lot of good resources. One resource that I want to recommend that you can look further into if you have questions about maybe how to manage those micronutrient deficiencies is the Pocket Guide to Bariatric Surgery by the Academy of Nutrition Dietetics. It's a great resource. It's very precise. So if you have a problem, you can flip to the problem fairly quickly. And I think it will be a great resource for you. If you have more questions, if you handle these patients on a frequent basis, this could be a good resource for you. So once again, hope this was helpful. Thank you for watching. If you have any questions, let us know, and we will try to answer those as fast as we can. Thank you.